去拿苹果呀，阿里巴巴呀，投个身，然后坐着等五年，你又不着急买房子。那比特币，你可得天天心惊肉跳的看着，天天那个不能
离开。没有没有，这个比特币你知道长线持吗？玩长线，
长线是300美金。要入神仙就说最后实在是没钱，那些人5毛钱的10块钱20块钱买做出来的东西，等等，然后等了300年，他也赚了。
嗯。
但是你现在这8000你也受不了啊，3000。
对，
又是从3000到3000。
是，现在一跌就几千美元，现在上到现在，是不是吗？
那算了吧，就那买私房钱给留着。干啥不好？
说了没味儿，吓人是吓人。这辈子大婚只能靠比特币。
人家那些不要命的，在网上搜所有带区块链的股票就买。第二天，妈呀！因为所有人都跟你干一样的事情，都是区块链，这样是个假的东西。
So move on to a new section, a new chapter of Kulvin Networks. 可以给上 preliminary note on Kulvin Networks. Well, basically, if you have a particular system.Okay, so let's say this is a system that you have. The equivalent of it tells us that you don't need to know the E and B. Okay, you don't need to know the E and the H within the entire network. Okay, so this is a system. You have E and H within it, but you don't need to know what is happening throughout the system.All you need to know is what is happening at the terminals. Okay, so this is terminal 1, this is terminal 2, this is terminal 3, 4, 5, and so on. What the equivalent network approach tells us is that all you need to know is the equivalent behavior at all these terminals. Okay, once you know these, we can basically characterize what's.Going on inside. Okay? Right, so that's what the first point is all about. Representing known or unknown device circuit or system by only considering the behavior at specified terminals. Okay? So looking at what's happening at the terminals is good enough. You don't need to open up the system to see what's inside. Okay? That's the power of this particular approach. Now we need to specify the frequency range of validity.Okay. Every time you build a model, you basically need to invite certain assumptions or approximations. So that tells us that each of these assumptions or approximations will have its own range of validity. Okay? So you need to specify the frequency range of validity to reference your assumptions and approximations. So for example, low loss. Okay? Loss.It's not always low at all frequencies, it is low at certain frequencies, and if you go beyond that, then of course your assumption starts to become invalid. Now, once you create a model, you find that your model may incorporate certain elements that are not physically realizable. Okay? A good example would be negative resistance. Okay?So for instance, if you have a particular network, right? So if you have a particular network and your VI relationship looks like this, then we know that for this region here, you have negative resistance, okay? So the model tells you that there's negative resistance, but of course, in real life, you can't realize that.Negative resistance, okay? But the model insist that it is negative. Possibility of deriving or applying special properties. Right, this one we'll see later on in this particular chapter. There's this thing called realizability analysis. Right, so in this particular chapter, we'll be dealing with realizability analysis. It's a very powerful tool. It allows you to check whether or not a particular set of specifications can be satisfied. Okay, so if your boss or your client tells you that they give you $1 million to design something, and you find from the realizability analysis that it cannot be done, then there's no point in accepting that particular assignment. Okay? Because realizability analysis tells you that it is a futile exercise. Okay, so so this is the special properties that we're talking about. Equivalent networks also facilitates collaborative design. Nowadays, designs are not done in one particular company. Okay, if let's say my company wins a huge contract. Unfortunately, not all the expertise that are required can be found within my company. So what I'll do is I'll subcontract part of the work to somebody else. Okay? Subcontract part of it to someone in India, and then subcontract another part to someone in the States. Okay? But I need to communicate with my subcontractors in the States and in India. And in this case, the best way of communicating is via equivalent networks. Okay? So instead of specifying the E and H at every point in the system, all I need to do is to tell the chap in India, tell me what is happening at your equivalent, at your terminal. Okay? As far as I'm concerned, if the terminal voltages and currents give reasonable results, I can accept what it's doing within the system. Okay? I need not know what is designed. All I need to know are what's happening at the specified terminals. Right, now the most common representation that we have is an impedance representation. Okay, so for one port device, that's your famous Ohm's law. Okay, so if this is your one port device, and this is the terminal of interest, all I need to know are your V and I here. I do not need to know what's inside the system. Okay, now this is good for one port device. What happens if you have a multi-port device, like so? Okay, so in this case, it's an N-port circuit, and there are N of these terminals, and each one of them you have a V and an I. Okay, so how do we represent this? Well, instead of a scalar equation like this, we rewrite this as a matrix equation. Okay, like so. Right, so V1 will be dependent on I1, I2, I3, I4, all the way to IN. And the coefficients are Z11, Z12, Z13, Z1N. Okay? These coefficients are your impedance coefficients. And each one of them is defined in accordance with this formula. Okay? ZMN, right? This one is, of course, in matrix notation. So ZMN is basically Vm divided by In, where all the other I's are zero. Okay, so Ik, where k is not equal to n, must be set to zero. Okay, so basically this here tells you that you need to set everything open circuit. So for example, Z23. Okay, what's the definition of Z23? According to this, it is V2 divided by I3, where I1 is 0, I2 is 0, I4 is 0, I5 is 0, In is 0. Okay, so that's the definition of Z23. Right, so admittance representation, what's the converse of the impedance representation? Okay, for the admittance representations, your eyes, eye parameters are on the left hand side. For impedance representations, your V1, V2, V3, and so on are on the left hand side. Right? So all the V terms are on the right hand side, and the definition is the converse of it. Okay? So now it's IN divided by VN, where VK, where K is not equals to N, is zero. Okay? So basically, if let's say I want to know Y31, the Y31 is I3 divided by V1 after short circuiting all the other terminals. Okay, so V2 is zero, short circuit that. V3 is set to zero, short circuit that. Vn is set to zero, short circuit that. Okay? Right, so let's have a look at the admittance representation for this particular transistor circuit. Okay? Let me set up the Y matrix for this two-port network. Okay. Right, I want to get hold of Y11. Okay, what is Y11? Y11 is equals to I1 divided by V1, where V2 is set to zero. Okay, that's the definition. Now this is V2. Right, so I set V2 equals zero. So V2 is zero, okay? So this is V1. This part here is zero, okay? We set V2 to zero, so this part is zero. Now V1 across this capacitor, V1 is also across this capacitor, because this is zero here, okay? So this V1 is here to here is V1. So here to here should also be V1, simply because this is now set to zero, okay? So what's the total I1? Where is I1A here? And I1B. Right? So I1A is given by this. I1B is equals to this. So in this case, Y11 is equals to I1 divided by V1. I1 is I1A plus I1B. So this is Y11. Okay, how about Y21, okay? Right, so this is Y21, okay? Now I2 travels along here. I2 cannot go through this capacitor, because the moment any current goes through this capacitor, there will be a voltage difference. But we are told that V2 must be set to zero. Okay? So I2 cannot be diverted into this capacitor, neither can it be diverted into this resistor. The moment it flows into the resistor, V2 becomes non-zero. Okay? So I2 has to travel all the way to here. Okay? Right, now here I have GM V1. Okay, I have this particular I1B. We've already obtained I1B just now from here. I1B. Okay, so I ask myself, what are the currents flowing through this point P? Okay, at point P, I2 flows into it. I1B flows into it. This one flows out of it. So it is minus GM V1. Okay, right. So at point P, the sum of these currents using Kirchhoff's current law will be zero. Okay, so from here I can get hold of this one here. This is Y21. Okay, right. Now let's move on. Right, now I want Y12. Okay, so for the previous exercise, V2 was set to zero. Now, V2 is non-zero, but over the side, V1 must be set to zero. Okay, V1 must be set to zero. Now, if V1 is set to zero, then this current generator will not supply any current. Okay, because it's GM V1, V1 is zero, so there's no current provided here. So this one we can take it out of consideration. This is a transistor. The transistor is this GM is for this circuit.
Okay.
It's a transistor model.
Okay.
Right, so okay, so I need Y12. Right. So this current will flow. I need I1. I1 comes to this point, it will not be diverted to here. Because the moment it's diverted in here, there'll be a voltage drop here. But we're told that V1 must be zero. So I1 will flow through here. Okay? Now, this node here is V2. This node here is V2. This node here is zero. Because this is zero. So this node here is zero. Okay? Hence, your V2, which is here, is also here. Right? This is V2. Since this is zero, so this is also V2. Okay? Now in this case, this is V2 J omega C GB. And now in this case, the arrows of the voltage and the arrows of the current are parallel. So that tells us this is a minus here. Okay, this particular arrow is pointing to the right, this arrow is also pointing to the right. So these two, you need to put a minus sign here. Okay, so here is my Y12. Right? And finally, a 1.22. Right, a 1.22. Okay, so I2 will comprise three currents. I2A, I2B. Comprise these three current elements, and therefore you have this one here. Okay, any questions? right? Okay, now, impedance and admittance representations are very common for low frequency one, okay? And there's a tendency to try to extrapolate it to high frequency, okay? But the problem with having increasing frequency is that there is an inherent problem with V and I. So you look confused about this. Do you have any questions? Megahertz, and now I want to talk about gigahertz. Okay? Now in gigahertz, one problem is that the voltage definition is no longer unique. Is a very common transmission line. Okay? For your coaxial cable, if I want to know the low voltage difference between the two, I normally draw a straight line and obtain my V. Okay? So V is equal to minus E R V R from here to here. Okay? From okay, so that is your V. Now in this case, it's ER, DR, because I have a scalar line. Okay, I have a linear dimension, so it is of this form. I can equally change that into this form. Okay, I can equally change it into this vectorial form. Alright, then the next question to ask is, why must I choose this line? If I choose this line instead, will it work? Sorry. Okay, if I choose this line instead and use this contour integral, will it work? Yes, it will work, and it will give you the same answer. Okay, it will give you the same answer. That's because of conservative property. Okay, the path chosen is irrelevant. You will always get the same answer. Okay, now let's talk about waveguides. Now, for waveguide, we know that the E field okay, we know that this E field looks something like this. Okay, we just covered the chapter on waveguides. The E field looks something like this. Right, meaning you have maximum E field in the middle, and over here is zero. Okay, this is your E field. In the middle is maximum. Over in this side, next to the wall, is zero. Okay, now here I have a problem. Supposing I have this contour C1. Okay, so for this contour C1, I have V okay, but if I choose a contour that is next to the wall, So this one is called V1, this one called V2. Okay, if I choose a contour next to the wall, then the electric field here is extremely low. So that means that V1 and V2 are not equal. Okay? Here, they are always equal. Why? Because you're operating in TEM mode. Okay, we're operating in TEM mode. Take note that TEM is only for a particular frequency range. Okay, if you exceed frequency range, then you're no longer operating in TEM and your model changes. Okay? Here, however, we're not operating in TEM, we're operating in TE10. Okay, so first problem here, the voltage definition is no longer unique. Okay, depending on where you draw your contour C, you get different values of V. Okay, so your definition starts to fail, not starts to, your definition fails. Okay, secondly, you find that voltmeters and ammeters are not available at micro frequencies. Okay, let's push this to the limit. Micro frequencies are about gigahertz. But nowadays, we can push gigahertz to terahertz. And near at terahertz, you find that you are nearing optical frequencies. Okay? If they're dealing with light frequencies, nobody ever talks about an ammeter or a voltmeter at light frequencies. Okay? So that suggests to us that this particular thing here is problematic for increasing frequency. Okay? At kilohertz and megahertz, yes, fine, these assumptions still hold. But once you move up to gigahertz and terahertz, you find that there is a loss of inherent meaning for V and I. Okay? Then the other problem about your Z and Y matrix representations is that you need to be able to open circuit and short circuit your system. Okay, we already saw the emittance matrix for your transistor. You need to be able to set V equals to zero. Okay, now in real life, when you set V equals zero, especially when the circuit has transistors in it, your transistors, instead of amplifying, it will be set into oscillation. Okay, so you find that it's very inconvenient to want to short circuit or open circuit your terminations just for analysis purposes. Okay, your circuit changes its functionality. Third problem. Let's say this is a short circuit. We know from E2011E that when you look into here, although this is a short circuit, over here you may see an open circuit. Okay? So that is problematic. How are you going to draw your equivalent circuit? Do you draw a short circuit or do you draw an open circuit? Okay? Another example, if this is a capacitor here, looking into here, you may see an inductor instead. Okay? So that's problematic because it suggests that you need to draw different equivalent circuits for different frequencies, okay, or different lengths of this L, right? For a particular length, for a particular frequency, you draw a circuit. For a particular circuit and a particular frequency and L, you draw this as your equivalent circuit, but just because you change your L or you change your F, you find that you need to change the equivalent circuit representation. Okay? So this is extremely inconvenient. Hence, what do we do? Well, back in 1965, or thereabouts, there was a new representation that came up to replace Z and Y representations. Okay? That new representation is called scattering representation. Okay? After 1965, it became very popular, and these days, it is difficult to do any designs without knowing anything about scattering matrices. Okay? Now, before I plunge into it, just a word of caution. Scattering representation is not a cure-all for everything. It also has its problems. Okay? So, towards the end of this chapter, I'm going to show you other types of representations that we may use instead of the scattering representation. Okay? But, for now, we'll go into the scattering representation. Okay? It's very commonly used, and when the problems arise, I will highlight that for you. Okay? So, now we're going to use scattering representation to replace the Z and Y representation. Right, how do we start? We start off by looking at these two equations that came from your transmission line analysis. Okay? So in this case, your V, which is a function of Z and T for your transmission line, okay, is basically given by this, and your current is given by this. Okay? Now we will define A at port N, A to be proportional to the forward wave. This is your forward wave, this is your reverse wave. Okay? If you remember your transmission line work, after the derivation of your okay, your transmission lines, you start off with this model. Okay. After the analysis, you find that you end up with a second order equation in V and I. Second order equation tells you there must be two independent solutions. Okay? So V plus is one. This one here is one independent solution. This is the other independent solution. How to interpret that? Okay, in E201E, we found that we interpreted it by saying that this is a forward wave and this is a reverse wave. Okay? So at E201E, you just merely use a V plus and V minus. Okay? Here we will change the notation. We'll say that A is proportional to your forward wave at port N, and Bn is proportional to your reverse wave at port N. Okay, so basically, I'm going to say that An is proportional to V plus at port A, and Bn is proportional to V minus at port A. Okay, now proportionality relations are not very useful because you can't do analysis. Okay. So I need to change this to an equal sign rather than a proportional sign. Okay? So I need to put an equal sign. And in that case, I need to put in some constants. Okay? I need to put in some constants. Right? What sort of constants should we use? Well, the constants that we're going to use is based on power. Okay? We use power as the basis of choosing the constant proportionality. So this C here is basically 1 over Z square root of Z naught. Okay, this is the constant proportionality that has been chosen. Right, for now, you may ask why. Okay, I'll show it to you in the next slide. Okay, so here, let's take it from me. You need to change your proportionality relations to equation relations, and we need to put this as your constant of proportionality. Right, so you take this and substitute into that, and you take this and substitute into that, you find that you have these two equations. Okay, you have these two equations. Right, now let's talk about power. Average power from your low frequency formulas is given by this. Okay, now Vn is written in this form, and In is written in this form. Okay, so let me put these two into here. So this is Vn, and this is In. Okay, IN, there's a complex conjugate here, so we must put complex conjugate here. Okay, now I will assume that Z0 is real. In E201E, when we talk about Z0, we always say it's 50 ohms, 75 ohms, 100 ohms. We don't say it's 50 ohms minus J watt. Okay, so it's always real. Okay, this is an ideal case. In real life, of course, Z0 is complex. Okay, in practice, Z0 is complex. But ideally, okay, since you're encountering this for the first time, let's make life simple. Let's assume that Z0 is real. Okay, so complex conjugate of a real term is still itself. Okay, right, this I have to multiply like this. When I do that, I get this answer. Okay? Now, if you look at this answer, this part is always real, and, but this part is always imaginary. Okay? Because there's a J term there. Right? The formula here says I need to take the real operator. Okay? So since I need to take this real operator, applying this, I will get this result, this and this, but this one will drop out. Because this is imaginary. Okay? So I will get this. Right? Now this here is can be interpreted as your forward power. And this here can be interpreted as your reverse power. Okay? And so that explains why we use this particular proportionality relationship. Okay? Because it gives you a power result, right? And power is very useful. Okay, your interpretation is in terms of power is very useful because at microwave frequencies and optical frequencies, you can you have plenty of power meters to do your measurement. Okay, you can't get voltmeters, you can't get ammeters, but you can certainly get power meters. Okay, so power is something that's convenient for use at microwave and optical frequencies. Right, let's get hold of the S matrix, or the scattering matrix. Now I start off with this impedance representation. Okay? Right, I start off with this impedance representation. Now scattering matrices can be for multi-port networks. Okay? But since we are doing it for the first time, let's look at two ports. Okay, two ports are easy to understand, right? So let's look at two ports first. Later we'll look at four ports and five ports. But let's start off with two ports. Okay, so this is your two port Z matrix. Now, let's replace V1 and V2 and I1 and I2. Okay. The formulas are given in the previous slides. Okay, so this is V, N, so V1, this one's A1 plus V1, V2, this is A2 plus V2, okay, and so on. I1, this is A1 minus V1, I2, this is A2 minus V2. Okay, so take that and substitute into here. Okay. Right, I would like to have my B terms on the left hand side and all my A terms on the right hand side. So let me rewrite. Okay, here's a pair of linear equations, but this pair of linear equations can be rewritten more elegantly in matrix form. Okay, so I have this. Right, this particular matrix is not singular. Okay, the researchers or the scientists have tested this and found it's not singular. So I can find the inverse for this. Okay, I can find the inverse for that. So that gives me this 3 multiplied by the inverse. Okay, I have V1, V2 here, and I have this here. Okay, right, this matrix, take the inverse of it, multiply by this matrix, will always give me another matrix. That matrix, I write it in this form. Okay, S11, S12, S21, S22. Okay, this is your scattering matrix. Now, how to interpret the four entries then? If this is your device under test, okay, DUT stands for device under test, A1 is an input wave, okay, so an input wave travels to this way, A2 is an input wave at port 2, okay? These two are output waves. B1 is your output wave here coming out. B2 is your output wave coming out. Okay? Now, let's look at this wave here, A1. A1 travels down. Okay? B1 will be equal to S11 times A1. Okay? B1 is equal to S11 times A1. This is B1. So A1 travels here, hits this device, part of it gets reflected back. That will be your S11. Okay, let me draw it out. So I have A1 coming here, okay, it gets reflected, so this one will be S11, A1, okay, it gets transmitted, so this will be S21, A1. Now the output wave is B1, the output wave here is B2. Okay, so this S11, A1 contributes to B1. Right? B1 is equal to S11 times A1. B2 is equal to S21 times A1. Okay? So this part gets reflected back, contributes to B1. This one gets transmitted through, it contributes to B2. Okay, so that's how we interpret it. Now let's look at A2. Right, A2 comes along, gets reflected back, it is S22 A2, gets transmitted through, becomes S12 A2. Okay, right, let's look at B1. This contributes to B1. Okay, so B1 is equal to S12 times A2. Okay, B1 is equal to S12 times A2. It's due to this part here. A2 hits here, gets transmitted through, comes here, S12, A2. Okay? And then B2 is equal to S22 times A2. Okay? So here is A2. It hits this, gets reflected back, S22 times A2, and this contributes to B2. Okay, so basically your B1 comprises two components. One is S11 A1, the reflected component of A1, and the other one is S12 A2, the transmitted component of A2. Okay, then B2 comprises two components. One is S21 A1, this is the transmitted component of A1. And the other one is S22 A2, the reflected component of A2. Okay? So that's how we interpret this scattering matrix. Right? Right, so I'm going to give you an illustrative example, okay? Now, the third line is illustrative, okay? If you don't understand it, never mind, it won't come out in exams, okay? What I'm showing you is what is expected from introductory lecture, okay? But in terms of actual applications, we hardly go through this piece of analysis, okay? So the analysis is for illustrative purposes to try to explain to you what this scattering matrix looks like, okay? But that is not how we apply scattering matrix, so don't get too perturbed by it. Right, I have a junction of two transmission lines. Over here, the transmission line has characteristic impedance of 50 ohms, and over here, the transmission line has scattering matrix of 75 ohms. Okay? And then there's a shunt emittance of 50 ohms here. Okay? Right, I want to get hold of an S matrix. Now, to put everybody on the same page, let's write it up. Okay, first thing I want to do is get hold of S11. S11 is B1 over A1, where A2 is 0. Okay, S11 is B1 divided by A1, where A2 is 0. And I also want to get hold of S21, which is B2 divided by A1, where A2 is 0. Okay? Let's start out with these two. Then after that, I'll get hold of these two. Okay, let's do this one first. Right, I need SA2 to be 0. I need A2 to be 0. Okay, that's by definition. How do I get A2 to be 0? If I send a wave down here, this wave will get transmitted through and get reflected back. Okay? To ensure that there's no reflections, I must terminate it in the characteristic impedance. Okay? So I must terminate it in 75 ohms so that there's no A2. Okay? I repeat. The definition says A2 must be 0. How do we get A2 to be 0? By matching, or rather, by terminating port 2 in the match load. Port 2 has characteristic impedance of 75 ohms. So, for the first part, which is to divide these two, I must terminate port 2 in 75 ohms. Okay? Now, when I do that, I ask myself a question, what is the impedance looking to here? It is basically 50 ohms in parallel with 75 ohms. So that is my Zin. Okay? If that is my Zin, then my gamma in, this is our, this is gamma. So gamma in is this. Zl minus Z0 divided by Zl plus Z0. Okay? So Zl or rather Zin is 30 ohms minus 50 ohms. Okay? We're talking about this side. This side is 50 ohms, this side is characteristic impedance of 75 ohms. Okay? But I'm looking at port 1, so the characteristic impedance is 50 ohms. Okay? So that is minus 1/4, and S11 is B1 divided by A1, okay? Which is this, and that is equals to minus 1/4. Okay? Right. I've done this. Now let me get hold of this. Right. I need to put in a forward wave. Okay? A forward wave V1 plus. Set it to 1. Okay? If you don't want to set this to 1, never mind. Later on when we divide, it will be eliminated. Okay, so V1 plus, let's set it to 1. Right, this forward wave hits here, gets reflected back. Okay, so V1 will be V1 plus plus V1 minus. V1 plus has been arbitrarily set to 1. Okay, so V1 minus is gamma in. Gamma in is this check here, minus 1/4. So the net result is V1 is equal to 3/4. Okay? Right, since it is a shunt connection, V2 will also be 3/4. Right, shunt connection, V1 and V2, they are the same voltage. So if V1 is 3/4, V2 will also be 3/4. Okay, so V2 is equal to 3/4. But V2 is equal to V2 plus plus V2 minus. V2 is equal to this. Okay? Now, this part here is the wave that's traveling this way. But we have said that this is 0. A2 is 0. Okay? This one is A2, or proportional to A2. Okay? So this is 0. Okay? So what do I have? Right, so V2 plus is 0, so that means the V2 minus is this. Okay, so V2 minus is equal to 3/4. Okay, so that allows me to get hold of my S21. S21 is V2 divided by A1. V2, according to the definition, is this. Okay, V2 minus, that's 3/4 here. So 3/4 here. Okay, divided by Z02, so divided by Z02 is 75 volts. Okay, then divided by A1 is this by definition. This part here, we have arbitrarily set this to 1. Okay, so to normalize it, if you set it to another value, never mind, this one you divide it. Okay, so you normalize it, right? So this one, V1 plus is normalized to 1. Z01 is 50 ohms. Okay? So S21 is equal to this value. Any questions thus far? Like I said, we will not be using this, okay? I need to show you this, right? After showing you, then when we apply it, we're not going to make use of this piece of analysis, okay? So this is for illustrative purposes. Right, so I have gotten hold of S11 and S21. Now let me get hold of the other two. S12 is equals to V1 over A2, where A1 is 0. Now in this case, I need A1 to be 0. How do I get A1 to be 0? By terminating port 1 in its characteristic impedance. Okay? Right, now I send a wave this way. Okay, just now I send a wave from left to right. Now I send a wave from right to left. Okay? I do not want any reflected wave from port 1, so I need to terminate port 1 in this characteristic impedance, which is 50 ohms. Okay? So that's what I have here. Port 1 is terminated in 50 ohms so that there's no A1. Okay? A1 will drop to 0. Right? So again, set in, looking to here, I see 50 ohms in parallel with 50 ohms. That gives me 25 ohms. Okay, so gamma in, looking to here, this part here, the characteristic impedance is 75 ohms. Okay, so 25 minus 75 divided by 25 plus 75, this gives me minus half, and this is your S22. Then, the forward wave that's sent here, let me normalize it to 1, okay? Right, then what is V2? V2 is V2 plus, which is normalized to 1, plus V2 minus, okay? V2 minus is gamma in. Gamma in is over here, so the answer is half, okay? Now, this is a shunt connection, so V1 is equals to V2. Right, so that means that V1 equals V2, V2 is half, so V1 is half, okay? But V1 is equals to two components. In general, it's a forward wave and a reverse wave, okay? But we know that the forward wave is zero. By definition, we need to set it to zero, and we did that by terminating this in its reference impedance. So this one is zero, this one is non-zero. Okay, so I get this particular result. So that tells me that V1 minus is equals to half. Okay, so I apply the definition. I get this for S12. Okay, S12 is V1 divided by A2. V1 is this, A2 is this. Okay, V1 minus, what I just obtained it here, is half. So V1 minus half. Is that not 1 over here? 50 ohms. V2 plus has been normalized to 1, okay? So V2 plus, which is here, is 1. Z02 appears up here, 75 ohms, and this is S12. Okay? So I combine everything, I get this as my scattering matrix for that particular circuit. Right? Like I said, if you find difficulty understanding this, never mind, this is just for this is just to show you how it's done, but when we apply it, we're not going to go through this exercise. Right, now, supposing I have S matrix for this blue box, okay, this blue box. Now for this blue box, the S matrix is given by this. Okay, the S matrix is given by this. Right, so this is a small A1, small B1, small A2, small B2. Now, this particular sketching matrix is for this terminal plane. And this terminal plane. Okay, for this terminal plane and this terminal plane. So these two blue arrows, are for these terminal planes, okay? What if I change my terminal plane? What if instead of this terminal plane, I now want to operate from this terminal plane? And same here, from this terminal plane, I operate from this terminal plane, okay? If you remember, we had problems just now when we changed your terminal plane, okay? If we started off with a capacitor, we could end up with an inductor here, right? So it's very difficult to draw an equivalent circuit simply because a capacitor can become an inductor simply because you change your L or you change your frequency, okay? So this part here is very inconvenient. Now, does the S matrix help us to solve it? If it doesn't help us, then obviously it's of no use. Okay, but fortunately it does help us. Okay, so let's proceed. If this is the new terminal plane, let me draw a red arrow, these red arrows, to represent the scattering matrix for the red boundary. Okay, so for the blue boundary are the blue arrows, for the red boundary are the red arrows. Now, I've deliberately put this in uppercase, okay, so as to distinguish it from the lowercase, which are for the blue box. Right, how is the big A1 related to small A1? Well, big A1 travels this length L1, it becomes small A1. So big A1, after traveling this length L1, it becomes small A1. So small A1 is basically equals to big A1. Multiplied by phase delay. Okay, small A1 is basically big A1 after having traveled down this length of L1, which introduces a phase delay. Okay? How about this one? Big B1 is equals to small B1 after it's traveled this. So big B1 is small B1 with a phase delay. Over this side the same. Small A2 is equals to big A2 after traveling L2. Okay? So is this one? A2, small A2 is equals to big A2 with a phase delay. And then big B2 is equals to small B2 after it's traveled L2. Okay? So big B2 is equals to small B2 with a phase delay. Okay? Now these phase delays are due to L1, whereas these phase delays are due to L2. Okay? Right, so let's substitute these four equations into here. Okay? So I convert all my lowercase a and b into uppercase a and b. Okay? Right, now I want big B1 and big B2 on the left hand side, and everything else on the right hand side. Okay? So I do some simplification. Big B1 is here, big B2 is here, everything else is pushed to the right. Okay? So I basically get this. This here is my new sketching matrix for the red boundary. Okay? This here is my sketching matrix for the red boundary. Right? This is in its full-fledged version. This is in matrix version. Okay? So this part here is S11 for the red boundary. This part here is S21 for the red boundary. This part here is S12 for the red boundary. And this here is S22 for the red boundary. Okay? So we see that a change of boundaries can be easily accommodated. All you need to do is put in the phase delays. Okay? You know the phase delays are different. So this is L1, this is L2, this is L1 plus L2. Okay? So this is much more convenient than what we saw for your Z matrix or Y matrix. Okay? So because of this convenience, we find that the S matrix is certainly the way to go for high frequency work. Okay. Right, now let's do some analysis. I want to be able to apply my S matrix to analyze circuits. Okay, so here is my 2-pot network and it's terminated and they have load. Right, so this is a very simple circuit, 2-pot network, terminator, and the load. I want to find what is my gamma in. Okay? Right, so for this particular network, these are my two equations. Okay? These are my sketching matrix equations for this 2-pot network. Now, over on this side, the wave A2 is equal to gamma L of B2. Okay, B2 hits, B2 impinges on the load, gets reflected back. Okay, so A2 must be equals to gamma L times B2. Okay, A2 must be equals to gamma L times B2. So let me put that in. A2 here is equals to gamma L times B2. Okay, A2 here is equals to gamma L times B2. Right, let's analyze the two equations. This particular equation has only one unknown. Now I treat A1 as known because A1 is the wave that comes from the source. Okay, since we are the one who set up the wave, we ought to know what it is. Okay, So let's treat A1 as known. This first equation has two unknowns, B1 and B2. The second equation has only a one unknown, B2. Okay? So that means I can get the answer straight away from second equation. B2 is equals to this. Okay? Now, since I know B2, I take that result and substitute into here. I can then get hold of B1. B1 is then given by this. Okay? Have a good look at it. Alright, so this is what the analysis tells us. Before I move on, this set of terms is going to be commonly encountered, so we give it a symbol gamma A. This is also commonly encountered, we give it a symbol tau. Okay, tau for transmission coefficient.
Yeah. Should it always reflected over the incident? B1 over A1?
Yeah, we always divide it by A1 because we want to normalize it. Okay? Otherwise, the answer will depend on what your A1 is. So we want to get rid of the dependence on the value of A1, so we divide by A1. Okay? Right, so this analysis is what we call a frequency domain analysis. Okay? Frequency domain analysis. Now let's do it. Right? So I've written it here, frequency domain analysis. Let's now do a time domain analysis. Time domain analysis is very simple. You just follow in time what is happening. Okay? So here I send in a wave A1. Let's make life simple, let's normalize A1 to 1. Okay? So A1 comes in, impinges onto this. This reflects something back, reflects back S11. And then transmit S21. Okay? S21 travels to here, hits here, and gets reflected back. So we get S21 times gamma L. Okay, this S21 term travels to here, gets reflected by this, so it's gamma L. This travels back to here, okay, part of it gets transmitted through, so it's S21 gamma L times S12. Okay, transmitted through is S12. This one also gets reflected back. So it's S21 gamma L, this S1 gamma L with S22 for reflection, reflected back. This gets travels to here, gets reflected back again. Okay? So it gets reflected back. So it's S21 gamma L, S22 reflected back by this is gamma L. It comes over the other side, gets transmitted through. Okay? So S21 gamma L, S22 gamma L, and this one is the transmission coefficient. Okay? And then gets reflected back, right? This whole lot, and then multiplied by S22 again. Yes, there's a square. It's being. Yeah, it's partially missing. Okay, right, so this travels down and gets reflected back again, and so we have this exercise of this thing bouncing up and down. Okay, right, let's collect all the terms. Okay, let's look at tau. Tau is the summation of the blue wavelet, the red wavelet, the purple wavelet, and all the other wavelets. Okay? The blue wavelet is this. The red wavelet is this. The purple wavelet is this. and so on. Okay? Now if we look at this here, we see that it's a geometric series. Okay, it's S to Y. It's a geometric series. Now we know from the mathematicians that a geometric series given by this has this particular answer. Okay? So in that case, this one here is A is S to 1 divided by 1 minus R. Okay? R is this term here, which is here. Okay? Now how about the refracted terms? Gamma in. Okay? Gamma in is this blue wavelet plus red wavelet plus purple wavelet plus all the other wavelets. Okay? The first purple the first blue wavelet is this, S11. The red wavelet is this, the purple wavelet is this, the next one is this, and so on. Okay? So if we look at it, S11 stands alone. So S11 I bring over here. This part is a geometric series. Okay? And for the geometric series, I use this formula. And the answer is this. This whole thing divided by this. Okay, so this on top here divided by this. Right? Okay, so we have derived it in two ways: frequency domain analysis and time domain analysis. The reason why I chose to use the time domain analysis is that you get a better feel, you get a better appreciation where all these terms come from. Okay? The frequency domain analysis, you get these two answers, but they are all a bundle of terms and you don't know where they come from. Okay? But after doing the time domain analysis, you at least appreciate what's going on. Okay? S21 is your transmission coefficient. So that's S21. And this part here is due to your multiple internal reflections. Okay? This is reflection from here, this is reflection from here. So this is your multiple internal reflections. Then this answer, this is your reflection coefficient. These are your transmission coefficients. Okay? S21 is after it's traveled to here, S21 here, S gamma L. So after reflected back is gamma L and S12 after it gets transmitted through. Okay? So S21 is transmission from left to right. Gamma L is reflected by this. S12 is transmission from right to left. Okay? So that's where the numerator here comes from. And the denominator is due again to your multiple internal reflections. Okay? Right. So the time now is 8:50. This is a good opportunity to stop. Okay? So next week, remember, we have tutorials at 6 o'clock. Okay?